compare with respect to this particular point in time, you'll find that all these instructions are actually using the value after. For example, sub needs the value here, the AND instruction needs the value here, and the OR instruction needs the value here. So it is quite possible to forward the value produced here to these instructions. Okay, right? You just need some extra hardware to be able to do that. Okay. And that's what is called a bypass path. All right? So for example, the output of the ALU here will get bypassed to the input of the ALU in the next cycle so that the sub instruction can consume the value. Okay, so this is what it looks like, logically speaking, that add instruction produces the value here and forwards it to the sub instruction in the next cycle. And it also forwards the value, so remember that the value is getting carried forward through the pipeline registers until it reaches this particular stage. So here in this register, the value is still available, which it can forward to this instruction, right? So that it can consume here. Okay. So the idea here is that you read a wrong value from the register file in the decode RF stage, for example here, but the bypassed value will override it. And we also discussed how to implement it. We require a bunch of comparators which will drive the selection of the multiplexers at the input of the ALUs, so that you can decide what value to consume. So the value in this particular latch will essentially get bypassed to the input of these two multiplexers. Or if you want to imagine separately, you can also have two separate multiplexers which will actually select between the register file value and the forwarded value, okay, based on the comparison of the register identifiers. Okay. Similarly, you can have an extra multiplexer here which would select between this value and the value that is being forwarded from the output of the ALU. And then you have this multiplexer as usual, which will select based on opcode whether to get the immediate or to get the next PC for branch computation. Alright? So that's the basic idea of bypassing. And then, of course, when you want to bypass from here, you do the same thing. Only thing is that you'll probably require longer wires. Okay, so that will also come here. So that will now select between this value and the value will forward from here. So now, as you can see, your multiplexer is getting bigger now. Previously, we had to select between this value and the value being forwarded from this latch. Now we have one more value to select from. Okay, right? Okay, so essentially means that as your source points of bypass increases, number of source points, you'll have bigger multiplexers. For example, if you look at this instruction, okay, right? What it will see, the input multiplexer, it will have a value forwarded from here. You also have a value forwarded from here, right? Okay, you cannot disable that bypass. That's always on. Only thing is that, and there is of course another value coming from the register file. Out of these three values, you have to select the correct one based on the register identifiers. Okay, right? What identifiers will compare here? So this particular instruction will essentially, this instruction, will essentially take R1 and R7. These are the sources, right? Okay. It will compare against, what will it compare against? It will compare against the destination of this instruction, which doesn't match, all right? So in which case, it will discard this bypass. Okay, that's discarded. But you'll find that this matches with this one, actually. So it'll actually consume this particular bypass value, this value, okay, right? Okay. So as you can see, what it means is that as your span of bypass network increases, you'll also require more and more comparisons to make. Okay. For example, here in this case, both of these will be compared against both of these, all right? And of course, only one of them will pass. So any question on this? Is the basic concept clear? So we also mentioned one thing that is about a phased register file. And that helps you in resolving these OR instructions bypass. So here, the point is that the value is written here in this particular cycle, right? And the OR instruction reads the value in exactly the same cycle from the register file. Okay. If you do not take any extra care, of course, the value that is read by this particular instruction will be wrong. Okay. It's guaranteed to be wrong. Because the value that is written here in this particular cycle will appear in the next cycle at the output of the register. That's how the registers are designed. Okay. So what we're saying is that, well, if we can squeeze the register write in only half the cycle, that is a positive, the first half of the cycle, and we read from the register file only in the negative, the second half of the cycle, then this problem goes away, because now R1 will be written in the first half of this cycle, and I'll read R1 in the second half of the cycle, and I'll get the data back. So that makes sure that this OR instruction doesn't require any bypass. You have to get the right value from the register file itself. Okay, so of course the condition here is that given your processor frequency, you can squeeze register write in half cycle and register read in half cycle. Okay. Otherwise it's not possible. Otherwise what will you do? Well, you'll have to enable another bypass path. Okay, right? Where this instruction will actually forward it to the execution stage. Okay. From the write back stage. Just one small issue here, that is, whenever you say that, so this is the end of the pipeline, right? Okay. So there is probably no latch here, or no pipeline register here. Okay. The question is, when I say that, well, I really don't have this phased register file write and read, okay, so register write will actually take the full cycle. Okay. Then where do we actually bypass it from? How do we accomplish this bypass? What is the meaning of this bypass? Where is it coming from? That? There is no pipeline register here to bypass from. The register file will have the value, that's right.
So we can get the value from
there. So you'll need a bypass from the register file itself, yeah. Right? Yeah. So that's the important point here, that is, you need a bypass path originating in the register itself. Okay, all right. Which will forward the value to this particular bit. Yeah, that's the important.
So, but we would have to identify from which register are we going to...
All registers will have...
Yeah.
Yeah.
But there should be a selector which selects from which register to give this. Okay, so
yeah.
All the registers are actually...
No, your question is very relevant. So you have 32 registers here, which value to source from, right? That's what you're asking essentially. Yes, right. So essentially we have to remember what value was just written in the previous cycle. So essentially, in effect, you have to introduce a pipeline register, which will hold the value for one more extra cycle, which was written in the last cycle. Okay, right? So in this case, R1 will be held in a special register, which was written in the last cycle and would be used to bypass to this particular stage. Okay, right? So it's just one register, which will always hold the register that is written to in the last cycle. Okay,
right? And so we also need the destination of the ART, we need the instruction for the ART instruction to guide the comparators.
The opcode.
Yeah, opcode and the destination register.
Destination is needed, but why do you need the opcode?
No, we don't need the opcode. We need the destination. So where?
To guide the comparators.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. So that's what I said. Right. If you look at this particular instruction, it will compare R1 R7 against R4 R1.
No, but the R1 and so it is actually.
Oh, where do you get this from? You're saying?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes. Right. So that's also in the latch, right? Up to this point, it's in the pipeline register. Because you need that to write to the register file, okay, right?
But
beyond this point, it's not there. That's what you're saying?
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's also you have to remember, the register ID. Yes, exactly. So here you will require a special register, which will hold the value and the register identifier.
Yes.
And which will be used here to activate the bypass. Okay. And what have we done? In effect, we have increased one more bypass path to this multiplexer. Now we have a bypass from here to here, here to here, and here to here, and of course one path coming from the register file itself, right? That is here. So out of these four, we'll select one. Based on what? So this instruction will compare R1, R9 against R6, R4, R1, okay, right? And this one will match with this one, so this one will actually get overridden. This value will come directly from the register file, R9. Is it clear? What if we had a longer pipeline here? We require more bypass paths. We require a much bigger multiplexer.
Okay.
So remember this implication that if you make your pipeline deeper, there are two things that will happen. One, your branch penalty is going to increase, that we already discussed.
Okay.
That is, if you increase your pipeline depth on this side, of the pipeline, okay, before the branch executes. And after the execution stage, if you increase the pipeline depth, you will make your bypass network more and more complicated. It will require more and more space. It will require bigger multiplexers. It will probably slow down your clocks at the time. And also, yeah, so we used this particular acronym to identify these hazards. These are called read after write hazards. Why? Because you're reading after this register is written. Alright? So we'll look at other types of hazards very soon. Okay. Yeah, so phase register file solves three cycle apart raw, otherwise you require one more bypass path magnetic here. And always feed bypass values to the ALU input. How many sources in the bypass network? So in this case, if you imagine that your register file is phased, okay, so we have just how many? Two sources, right? One coming from execution, one coming from here. Okay, all right. There are two sources of bypass. And till now, we have only seen bypasses going to the execution stage only. The destination that we have seen so far in the examples is only requiring a bypass up to the execution stage. So the question that is asked here is, do we need a bypass to the main stage also? Can you think of an example where there would be a bypass path terminating in the main stage? That is, the main stage needs some value coming from somewhere else. So what are the values that the main stage requires? What are the inputs to the main stage? There are two things that it requires for functioning. What are they? Sorry? A memory module needs two things. What are they?
Address and size.
Yes, you're right. Size is also one thing, yeah. And
value.
What kind of instructions require a value? Stores, exactly. So the memory needs an address for sure, right? Okay. Somebody has mentioned that it needs a size also. But however, the size is not very important here because it comes from the instruction opcode. Okay. So there is no dependence here. The size is not getting generated by somebody else. Okay. But address may get generated by another instruction. And of course, there is a value for stored instructions, which may get generated by another instruction. Okay. So there are two things that we need for the memory module. Now, can you think about a dependence? So there is a memory instruction which needs this address and value. And can you think of an example where one of these, or maybe both of these, getting generated by another instruction? So here's an example for that. We have an add instruction here, which adds R2, R3, and puts the result in R1. Then there's a load instruction, which uses R1 to compute the address, and puts the value in R4. And immediately after that, it stores R4 back to some other address. Okay. So actually, I'm copying a value from one part of memory to another part of memory. All right? Okay. So let's see how the pipeline will work in this case. So here is my add pipeline. Okay. So remember that time goes in this direction. The load instruction requires R1 getting generated by the add instruction. So there is a bypass path that will be activated here. All right? So R1 will be consumed from this instruction through this bypass path. And otherwise, the load doesn't require anything else, so it will compute fine. Okay. The store instruction has a double dependence. It needs R1 from add to compute the address, and it needs the value from load to generate the store value. Okay. So let's see how it works. So the mem to x bypass for this instruction will get activated to pass the value of R1. Okay. So R1 is needed here to compute the address. So remember that the memory operations compute address in the X stage, okay, right? And the load instruction will bypass the value from here to here for the store. Okay. So it is getting generated here, you can bypass it here. So this is an example where you need a mem-to-mem bypass. So is there any other situation where a mem stage needs to have a bypass value? Any other case? So here's a general question that you might think about that will help you answer many of these questions. That is, suppose I have a pipeline, right? And you're focusing on a particular string of pipeline, let's say S. and you're asking, tell me what are the pipe stages that can bypass values to the state S. So what can you say about those stages that are bypassing value to state S? Will they come before state S or after state S? For example, here, if I look at the X pipeline stage, will I require, or let's suppose, okay, let's look at MEM pipeline stage. Will I ever require a bypass coming from the X stage? I tell you no. Can you see why? Because X always appears before MEM. There is no way, there is no reason why I need to bypass actually. Okay. Because if you lay out the pipeline here, you'll always find that X appears before MEM. So there is no way I need a bypass from X to MEM. Because whatever currently is in X cannot, it has to be after the MEM instruction, right? The instruction that is currently in MEM, let's suppose this load instruction. When it is in the MEM stage, the instruction that is currently in X is actually after it. So bypass always comes from previous instructions. It cannot come from the next instruction. That's not possible, right? So whenever you are looking at a bypass, trying to resolve where are the possible sources of my bypass, it can only come from stages after me. It cannot come from stages before me. That's impossible. And of course, it can come from myself. That's possible. Right here, MEM to MEM bypass. Okay, that's possible. Okay. So in this case, since the only stage after MEM is write back, there could be a possibility of having a bypass pass from write back to MEM. And we'll come to that very soon. Okay, that particular possibility. So anyway, so how many destinations in the bypass network? So in this case, we have two. X and MEM. There are two destinations, okay, right? So what is the number of multiplexers that you require? So whatever number of destinations you have, whatever number of sources you have, there will be a cross product of that, right? Okay, and of course you have to look at how many inputs are there. So in this case, for example, you will require X to X. This bypass will require two multiplexers because there are two inputs to the execution pipeline stage, okay, right? And there is a MEM to X also, right? So there will be two multiplexers, each accepting two inputs from bypass and one from an register pipe. If I ignore the write back to X bypass for now. And the MEM stage will have just one bypass path for now. We'll come back to write back to MEM bypass very soon. And there will be one multiplexer selecting between this bypass value and the value coming in from the execution stage. So just to show you the diagram once more. So this is the store value, right? Coming from the register pipe. Yeah. Okay. So you'll be selecting the store value between this and the value that is getting bypassed from the output of the memory stage. Where is my value? Yeah, this value. Okay. This value will get bypassed here. Alright? I'll be selecting between this and this in the next cycle. Based on the comparison of the register identifiers. So in this case, I'll be comparing R4 with the destination of this one. And there will be a match, so I'll say, oh, okay, I have to take the bypass path. Okay. So yeah, so as you make the pipeline deeper, you need more and more bypass paths. Okay. So now the question is that, you know, till now, we have seen that in all the examples, even though we don't have the value ready in the register pipe, we can avoid all stops by bypassing. Okay. There is no bubble in any of these examples. We have bypassed the values exactly in time. Okay. No bubble here. Move up here, right? Okay. So then the question is it always possible? The answer is no. There will be stalls in certain situations. So here's an example for that. So this is a typical scenario where you require a bubble. An instruction here consumes a value that is loaded. Okay. So whenever you find that a value that is getting produced by a state S and needed by the next instruction, before stage S, right? The next instruction requires the value in the X stage. That's not possible to satisfy by a bypass. That's impossible. Okay. Why is that? So this is how it is described pictorially. So this is where the value is produced, all right? And this instruction needs the value here. That's impossible. Okay. That's a negative in time, all right? So however, this AND instruction is okay because it will require the X value. The value here, that will get bypassed. So in this case, you really have no choice but to use the bypass path. Okay. but to stall the sub instruction for one cycle.
You have to delay its execution by one cycle, and that has to happen here when the value can be bypassed from.
So these are normally called the technical term is pipeline interlock. Okay, so these are essentially stall cycles. So you need a hardware pipeline interlock to stall the sub by a cycle, the sub instruction. Okay. So this brings us to the acronym MIPS. So now I can explain what it stands for. It stands for microprocessor without interlocked pipe stages. So that's what MIPS stands for. So this is the only problem that MIPS had. So question now is, the name suggests that there is no interlock cycle. So there has to be a reason, there has to be a way to avoid this stall, right? So they rely on the compiler. So they call this particular slot a load delay slot, which they rely on the compiler to be filled by an independent instruction. So currently compiled MIPS code, in the early generations of MIPS, never had a dependent instruction on load in the load delay slot. So that reads you of this particular bubble, okay, all right? And which is why it's called microprocessor without interlocked pipe stages. It had the compiler to fill the load delay slot with something independent or a node. So which essentially means that the code that I'm showing here is actually illegal MIPS code. Okay. So of course the load delay slot got removed later in the later generations of MIPS, but in the earlier generations this was the case. All right. So this code will never get generated by a MIPS compiler. All right. So for your second assignment, the compiler that is handed out is actually a little more advanced. It can generate this piece of code. Okay. So you have to actually implement this particular interlock. So keep that in mind. Okay. Right. Any question?
Sir, phase execution is not possible in this case.
That's independent. Phase execution of the register file. Yeah, that's independent. Completely.
No, I mean between them and X, it's not possible because of latency of memory.
It could be possible. They did not do it. That's all. So there must be frequency constraints. Hey, you can phase every stage if you want. That's possible. By phasing every stage, essentially what you're saying is that I'm splitting the pipe stage into two halves. Okay. But really there is no latch in between. So it's a multi-cycle pipe stage. That's what it means, essentially. Any other question? Yes. So a little bit more on bypass and stall logic. So what does the bypass logic look like? How many forwarding paths? How large the muxes? So we have already discussed this. Okay, right? As you walk through your second assignment, these concepts will become even more clear because you get to draw multiplexers on a piece of paper to figure out what the logic should be. Okay, so, or if you can, without drawing, if you can fold it in your head, that's even better. But anyway, the point is that as you do that, it will become very clear how many of these things you require. What about load interlocks? So the question is, where should I detect this interlock? So you can see, if you go back to this example, there are many places where I can detect that there is a problem, right? I can detect it as early as here, as soon as the instruction is decoded. I can detect it in this stage that, you know, the value is not available and there is a hazard, so that I can install it here. But of course, so these are the two possibilities only in this case. But if you have a deeper pipe, there are many other options. Okay. However, detecting possible hazards early simplifies things. Okay, because you're not too far into the pipeline, which means you don't have too many things behind you, okay, so you can stall the pipe early, all right? And the fixed positions of RS, RT, and RD, these are the register identifiers from your MIPS encoding, are important for register file access and hazard detection, okay, because this simplifies matters a lot, because you know exactly what to compare, which positions of your instruction to compare against, okay? So in MIPS, all interlocks can be implemented in the decode state itself. So that's very good. That makes the design simple. You don't have to distribute the interlock logic all over the pipeline. You can just implement everything in one particular pipe stage. Okay. So that makes sure that if you implement all your interlock logic in the decode stage, what you have to do? You have to tell the fetcher to stall. That's one thing. Okay. The second thing is you have to put in no-ops into the forward direction of the pipeline. So you send all zeros to the execution stage. You have to keep on doing that until the interlock resolves. Okay. So MIPS R3K does not have any hardware interlock, as you have just mentioned. Compiler fills the load in the slot. But in generations ahead of that, they actually have the load interlock implemented in the decode step. Okay. So in this case, how do you implement the interlock? That's fairly simple, actually. As soon as this is decoded, you know the source of this instruction. Okay, all you have to do is you have to check the previous instruction, which is currently sitting where? Which is in which latch? Which is in this latch, currently sitting here, right? Currently executing here. Okay. So all you have to do is you have to take the content of this latch and check two things. Is the previous instruction a load instruction? And does the destination of the load match with one of my sources? That's it. If the answer to the both is yes, that means I have to stop. So essentially what I have to do is I have to tell the fetcher to stall for one cycle, and I have to feed all zeros into this particular latch in this cycle. Okay. Next cycle onward, the proper action will be given. And this one we have already discussed, branch target in decode RF. You can actually bring the condition execution also in this stage if you want to. That will only lengthen your cycle a little bit, but that will rid you of all branch buffers. Okay. But anyway, so I'll not go into that. We have discussed in great detail branches and all. So next thing is, till now we have looked at this simple pipeline, right? That fetch, decode, execute, write back. I'm sorry, fetch, decode, execute, memory, write back, okay, right? Where execution takes a single cycle. Okay. But that's far from what the reality is. There are multi-cycle execution stages, and the very reason for that is to primarily support floating point operations. These are much complex to be finished in a cycle. For example, if you think about a floating point multiplication, it's almost impossible to finish in a single cycle. Also, multiple functional units may be needed to avoid structural hazards. So, if you cannot pipeline these multi-cycle functional units, you may require multiple of these to avoid structural hazard. Okay. Because now, essentially, what you have to do is there is a delay of 10 cycles in a functional unit, which is not pipelined. The next operation cannot go in until this one finishes. Right? So, for 10 cycles, this will remain occupied. Which means to avoid structural hazards, you may have to have multiple of these units, so that the next instruction can also go to a different unit. So for the following discussion, we'll assume that we have four functional units, which consists of one integer ALU, which will do all the integer operations except multiplication and division. All right. We have a floating point and integer multiplier. So essentially, what we'll do is we'll carry out all our integer multiplications on the floating point multiplier, which we can do without any problem. Okay, all right. We'll have a floating point adder and subtractor, and we'll have a floating point and integer divider. So all integer divisions will be carried out on the floating point divider. All right. Okay, is it clear? The architecture. Okay. Now, a latency of an instruction is defined by the number of cycles needed to produce the result from the time it issues. The textbook defines it in a slightly different way, but we'll follow this definition in the lectures. All right, so don't get confused. So assume that integer ALU instructions have a latency of one cycle. So these are simple operations, so they can finish in a cycle. All right. Loads have a latency of two cycles. Why is that? Because we have already seen that, right? In the execute stage, it computes the address. In memory stage, it executes the load with the address. Okay, right? So that's why these two cycles. So from the time the instruction, the load issues, to the time the value is produced, it takes two cycles, X stage and memory stage. Okay. Floating point add is four cycles, floating point and integer multiply 7 cycles, and floating point and integer divide 25 cycles. Okay, so that's the model of execution, okay, right? So maybe I'll list it here so that we can remember. Integer ALU, one cycle. Loads, all loads, floating point integer, two cycles. Floating point add. When I say floating point add, remember that subtractions also happen on the same unit. Okay, all right. So, four cycles. And floating point multiply, also integer multiply, same, 7 cycles. And floating point divider, 25 cycles. Okay. Any question on this particular model of functional unit? Okay. So we'll use this in the subsequent slides to demonstrate how multi-cycle execution stages make your life much more complicated. So there is one more term to define, that is repeat interval of an instruction. This is number of cycles between two instructions in the same category that can execute without a structural hazard. So for example, number of cycles between two floating point additions that can execute is a repeat interval of the floating point adder. Okay. So it depends on how the functional units are pipelined. So for example, if the adder is not pipelined, you'll have to wait for 4 cycles before feeding the next instruction. Okay. So let's assume that all the units other than the divider are pipelined, okay, except this one. These are all pipelined. All right. So division has a repeat interval of 25 cycles, while other instructions can issue back to back, repeat interval of 1 cycle. Right? I can. So which means there will be seven different multiplication operations in the pipeline or the multiplier at any point in time. So what does the pipeline look like? So I have a fetch stage. I have a decode register file stage, and then I have different pipe stages, right? So I have I'll put it as ILUX, 1 cycle. Then I have a load pipeline, which is just XMM, right? Then I have a floating point adder, which has 4 cycles, right? So I'll say A1, A2, A3, A4. And similarly, I'll have M1, M2, M3, M4, M5, etc. up to M7. And divider will have B1, B2, up to B25. And at the end, I'll have a write back switch. All right? So all the instructions will produce values and write back in 1 second. Okay. So this looks very different from our previous architecture, right? Now I have, so let me, okay, maybe I'll put the B1 also here. So I have now 4 different pipelines going on, okay, right? And even for the load instruction, if I want, I could put a separate ALU to compute the address. Maybe I should do that. That's an address stage and a memory stage. So there are 5 different pipelines that I have, no? Okay. All right. They all get diverged from the decoder. So depending on the decoder outcome, I'll decide which pipe to send the instruction to. And finally, they will write back at the end to the register file. So clearly, you require more pipeline latches or pipeline registers. That's pretty clear. So between these stages, you require pipeline registers. Any other complications? So that's all about the remaining slides. Okay. So let's start with a simple one. Structural hazards. So divider is not pipelined. Okay. That poses a big problem because if you have 2 division operations which are separated by less than 25 cycles, you'll have a problem. The second instruction has to be stored. And that I can decide in the decoder itself. I want to implement all my interlocks in the decode stage. Okay. So whenever I have a division instruction, I'll check if currently there is anything in the divider. Okay. So that state can be easily maintained here, all right? So that I can stall the instruction. Okay. So clearly, that's going to introduce bubbles in my pipeline and reduce the CPI. Okay. So a slightly smarter thing that I could have done here is that I can only stall the instructions. So here, essentially, see, there are 2 things you can do. One is that whenever you push a divider here, you say that for 25 cycles, I'm not going to issue anything else. OK. Right? Because the register file will be written after 25 cycles. The other thing that you can do is you can say, well, I'll continue issuing instructions only when I get the next division, I'll check and then stop. Okay. So that's slightly better, in fact, much better than this. Because here essentially what you're trying to exploit is that division operations are not that frequent. Okay. So you'll have a lot more instructions to put into these four pipelines while the divided operates. Okay, right? That of course makes your life much, much more complicated. Because now you have to be very careful while fitting these instructions into these pipelines. You have to make sure that they're independent of the running division operation. Okay. So that's one problem about the divider. The second structural hazard arises due to register write ports. So here's an example. So let's take that example and see what happens actually. So I have a multiplication instruction. So how does it execute? Fetch, decode, M1, M2, M3, M4, M5, M6, M7, write back. Right? That's the timeline of the multiplication instruction. Okay. Then I have two more instructions, which I don't care. They fetch here. Then I have an add instruction. Okay. So let's see how it executes. Fetch, decode, A1, A2, A3, A4, write back. Then I have a couple more instructions. And then I have a load instruction, which has fetch, decode, X, mem, and then you have a write back stage there. Okay. Right? The problem is with these two instructions. They try to access the register file in the same cycle. They want the write port in the same cycle. They may be writing to different registers, but they need two separate write ports to be able to write. Right? So that's another structural hazard that come up because of this different latencies of instructions. So you have to be careful in scheduling the register write port. You have to make sure that there is no clash in the write back stage. Okay. Because unless you have more ports, you cannot really allow this to happen. Okay. So again, so here's a solution. You either have more write ports, or you have to introduce hardware interrupts, which means stall cycles. Okay. So where do you introduce this interlock, this particular register write port interlock? So what are the options? You could detect right here that there is going to be a clash in the register write port when this instruction goes through, because I know exactly the latency of this. I know exactly the latency of this, so I can calculate actually in the decoder sitting here that whether there will be a contention for register write port or not. Okay. So usually this is implemented using a shift register write port scheduler. So essentially what you do is you maintain a shift register. So when this multiplication operation issues after the decode, you calculate how many cycles hence it will actually access a register file. Okay, all right. So these are essentially bits in my shift register. They correspond to the cycles. Okay, right. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So in this cycle, M1 will execute. This cycle, M2, M3, M4, M5, M6, M7, write back. So I'll mark a 1 here in the write, in the shift register. Okay, all right. So when this instruction goes, so every cycle I decode a new instruction, I'll shift this register on this side by one position, right? So by the time I decode this instruction, this bit has moved where? So in this instruction, this bit moves here. This instruction, this bit moves here. Okay, all right? So when I decode this instruction, so this bit is sitting here at this point. Okay. So now I calculate for this one. This is A1, A2, A3, A4, write back. I move this bit one position when I decode this, and I find that, oh, there's a clash. In the same slot, this instruction is going to access the register file, and this instruction is also going to have. So whenever there is a clash, I introduce an interlock. So that, well, let's delay by one cycle to resolve this interlock. Okay, all right. So this bit will move on by one cycle. Okay. And then when this guy goes, it will actually follow it. So there will be two ones now. Subsequent instructions will check both the bits. So essentially what I'm doing is whenever I encounter a new instruction, I prepare a mask with exactly 1 bit on. I AND it with this particular register. If the output of AND is non-zero, I know that there is a clash. And I have to stall the current instruction. Right? How many cycles I have to stall? So I have to check by stalling by each cycle to see if the thing resolves. Okay, until I get a zero outcome from the AND operation. Alright? So that's one option I can detect in the decoder. The second option is I will let it go and detect it in the memory stage or the write back stage. Okay, so essentially memory write back in this case is the last stage. Okay. So essentially I'll say, well, I'll delay until I reach there and then I'll detect. Okay, which is fine also. The only problem is you have to introduce stalls, you may have to introduce stalls to multiple different pipelines. Okay. Here I'm showing only two instructions that have a clash. There will be more. For example, if I did not have this instruction here, if I had the load here, this would also clash. Like for example, if this instruction was a load, right? This would actually have a write back here. Okay, so you may have to stall multiple pipelines if you delay until write back. Stall which one? So I have these two instructions, maybe more. Which one should I stall? Everybody except the first one, right? Okay. Only the oldest instruction will be allowed to proceed. Others will be stopped. Okay, all right. Is this clear to everybody? These two structural hazards, one involving register and write port, and another involving divide. So any non-pipeline unit will have a hazard, and your write ports may have a hazard depending on how you resolve the scheduling. You'll have new raw hazards. So here is one more example. Let's work through this. So by looking at this, you can see that, let's see, what are the dependencies? This add instruction consumes the result of the multiplication, and it also consumes the result of the load. So both of the sources depend on two previous instructions. So this is my load, fetch, decode, execute, memory. Okay, the traditional pipeline for load, okay? Mult, fetch, decode. Does it have any dependency? No. Okay. M1, M2, M3, M4, M5, M6, M7, write back. Okay. Add, fetch, decode. Why you need F0? Which is produced only here. Right? You have a long stall, many bounds. You cannot start A1 until this cycle, where you can actually have a bypass, M7 to A1. However, the load instruction will complete by then, so there is no problem as such. So you can have you can have the value bypassed, you know, so in this particular cycle. Okay. And then I have a store, fetch. This is stalled, cannot do anything. You can only decode here, and it will continue like this. Okay. So you have now more hazards that you take care of. Okay. Now there's a new type of hazard, which is write after write. So you have an add instruction, which produces $F2. You have some instruction, and then you have a load instruction, which also produces $F2. Okay. So let's try to see what happens in the pipeline. I think I was skipping the mem stage altogether here. That cannot be skipped. Then I have the load. things. Okay. Okay, yeah. So web stage is actually skipped, so there's no problem. All right, so you can see that there is a problem, right? In this case, both the instructions are writing to the same register in the same cycle, right? So if we have already implemented the write port scheduler interlock, we'll have resolved this, right? So this instruction will essentially get delayed by one cycle in the decoder, okay, and then it will move and write to the register file with no problem. And I move the load instruction a cycle ahead. So there is no write port scheduling clash, right? But there is a problem. What is that?
The later instruction is writing before the.
Exactly. So what is the final value of $F2 that will survive? That instruction, right? Which is not correct. The $F2 should have the value of the load instruction at the end of this sequence of instructions. Okay. So this is called a write after write hazard. Okay. You have the same destination and the earlier instruction is writing later than the next instruction. Okay. So the okay, so of course this is a problem, but before that, let's try to ask the question that is this realistic at all? Can this really happen that there are back-to-back two instructions, they write to the same register? What is the meaning of this? If you think about a program, I do an addition operation, write to a variable x, right? In the very next instruction, I say x equal to some value, right? So this can be equivalent to a C code which says x equal to, let's say, y plus z. And then I say x equal to a0. Why did I do this add operation, actually? I've never used the result of that. Right? That doesn't make any sense, right? So the question really is that, can this really happen? And here is a code which is straight from MIPS compiler. So of course, there could be many other situations where this can happen. for example, if you, instead of doing an addition, if you did a multiplication here, you would have a much longer pipeline. And even if you have put a few instructions in between before the load, you'll have the same problem. So here what happens is that the compiler filled in the branch delay slot with an instruction with target F0. Okay. All right, so this instruction will always execute. And then the branch jumps to the label where you actually load a new value into this register. This is a perfectly legitimate code. There is no problem with this. And this will lead to the same problem in all result. All right, so the question is that how do we really handle this? So again, we'll take the same procedure, that is, we'll introduce interlocks. Delay issue of the latter instruction or prevent the earlier one from writing. Okay. There are two things we can do. One is that we can figure out that this load instructions write is not going to be of any use. Okay. So I'm sorry, this add instructions write is not going to be of any use. So we can nullify that write back completely. Okay. And the second option is that we can delay this particular instruction, okay, by however many cycles is needed, okay, so to make sure that the hazard goes away. And again, we can do this in the decode stage, again with the help of a shift register circuitry, the same way, okay, maybe slightly different way. Okay, we should essentially look for not only just clash in the write port, but we'll also check that whether the register destinations are also different. And in that case, it will introduce delays. Okay. Yeah, so what's the hardware? You can do this with the shift register. Okay, so for hazard detection, you need to look for integer as well as floating point hazards. So that's essentially that's what we have just seen here. Just focusing on the integer side is not enough. Integer and floating point instructions use separate register files, right? So there are two separate register files for these two. So you might wonder, could there be a bypass coming from an integer instruction going to a floating point instruction? Can that be possible? And the answer is yes, even though they operate on two different register pipes. Okay, so we'll look at examples very soon. Floating point load store uses integer registers as base. So this is one example where a floating point instruction may require a value to be bypassed from an integer instruction. Okay, like for example here, if $2 was getting computed in the integer pipeline, you'd have you might require a bypass from that instruction to this particular load, even though this load is actually a floating point load. Okay, all right. So there could be a hazard between integer and floating point instructions. Also, there are move instructions, MTC1 and MFC1. We have discussed this earlier when discussing the MIPS ISA, that move to or from floating point register file to integer register file. Okay. So why needed? We have also discussed this. Does anybody remember? Why would I need to move a value from floating point register file to integer register file, or vice versa? Type conversion, exactly. So if you want to cast a floating point value to an integer value, you would make a move from floating point register file to integer register file, and the other will require the move in the other direction. So in these last two cases, we need to detect hazards between integer and floating point instruction as well, because MTC1, that is move to floating point file, essentially will have a floating point register destination, okay, right? And an integer register source. And that source may get produced by an integer instruction. So there will be a hazard coming from integer instruction to this one. Similarly, MFC1 will have a target integer register and a source floating point register. Okay, so that may have a start a bypass to an integer destination. Okay, right? Because the destination is integer file, integer register here. Otherwise, hazards can happen between integer instructions only or floating point instructions only. Simplification made possible due to separate register files. So any problems of having separate register files? So this is a good thing, that it simplifies your bypass network, right? So if you did not have, you would have actually a lot more cases of bypassing if you would share the register file. Okay. So that's one reason why you not unify the register file. The other problem is that you probably require a bigger register file, which may actually slow down your pipeline. So that makes sense too. Divide them separately.